I'm here today with Mike Goodwin, who has traveled and photographed in many locations around the world. Today, we're going to talk about his trips to Iceland to photograph many of the country's waterfalls. So, Mike, when did you first go to Iceland?
I went back in July 2016 with my son. It was a father and son adventure. We did a 10-day self-drive tour around the island. And I thought it was so beautiful. Everywhere we went, I kept thinking to myself, I want to bring Kathy here. Kathy's my wife. And so that was it for the next year. I just had to keep on her. Let's go to Iceland. And we ended up in September 2017 going to Iceland again. Or I did. Got to take her back. It was amazing.
So you went at different times a year to Iceland on your trips. What differences did you notice?
Well, when we went in the summertime, it was beautiful weather. We were quite lucky. There were times that you could go in t-shirt and shorts. Now, there were also times when we had to bundle up during our trip in July. But it was sun pretty much the whole time. Even when we went to bed, it was still sunny out. Following up in September, when we went, I wanted to go in September because I wanted to see the Northern Lights. So I talked Kathy into going when it was cold. And the differences besides the light were tourists. And I'm a tourist as well, but there were tons and tons. Just the tourism in the summertime is crazy. People on people. In September, it was still busy, but it was a lot more manageable.
Tell me a little bit about how you prepare for such a trip. If you go there for quite a while, what's your preparation routine?
Well, I'm a visual learner, so I watched a lot of video. Mads Peter Iversen is number one as far as videos are concerned. Our first time, because I was getting more and more interested in photography, and I really didn't have a lot of knowledge of Iceland, so following his videos was great. And then for the second time around, there's a vlogger out there called Sorella Moore, and at the time she was living in Iceland, and she was doing a lot of feature videos from various parts of the island. Most of my research was done online through video.
After that research, what other planning did you do?
Well, between the two of us, my son and I, like I said with the video, he really likes his Lonely Planet guides. He does a lot of traveling as well. He pretty much read the Lonely Planet guide, I'm going to say, front to back. He ended up being my tour guide because we'd get to some locations that I wasn't prepared for, I didn't know about, and he would say, oh yeah, this location, there's this church or what have you. As far as the second trip, I went the other way. I went over the top with my preparations. I had sun charts. I went on to Sunseeker and I found sunrise, sunset times. I did a screen grab, saved it on my Google Docs. I set up a Google map so I knew exactly every location we were going to. I even mapped out gas stations, because gas stations can be few and far between in certain parts of the island. I mapped out grocery stores. Because from the first trip, I noticed that some grocery stores can be more expensive than the others. So yeah, I really got a little carried away with my preparations the second time around.
Tell me, what cameras and what lenses did you take with you?
The first trip I took, I had a little, I still have it, a little Sony NEX-7. It's a crop camera, and it has fantastic image quality. I took it with the 18-55 kit, 55-210, and I also had a Canon adapter that I took my 10-22 wide angle. But that was it. And I borrowed a little Sony backup body just in case, and luckily I didn't need it on that trip. The second trip around, I went the other direction. I went a little over the top. I took my whole Canon kit at the time. I was shooting on a 7D. I took my 70-200 f/2.8 L glass, my 24-70 f/2.8 L glass, both really heavy lenses. Again, my 10-22. Plus, I packed my Sony camera as the backup. So the challenge with the second trip was, I was carrying heavy. I was 22, 23 pounds worth of gear. And that second trip, it convinced me that it was time to make a change. And then I decided to carry on to Micro Four Thirds for my future trips.
Do you have a favorite lens for shooting waterfalls? Did you find one works better than others? One that you went to as your go-to lens?
I was sort of back and forth between my 10-22, my wide angle, and my 24-70. I would stay in the 18-22 range, or on the 24-30 mil range, because a number of the waterfalls you can get close enough to, that I wanted to take it all in one shot. I'm getting into post-processing. I didn't want to do a lot of compositions. It just, like I said, it was one shot. But yeah, there was one or two occasions when I had the long lens out, but I didn't really need it for the most part.
What tips would you give to other photographers planning to go to Iceland in terms of gear, clothing?
Be prepared to get wet. Summertime, beautiful weather, even sunny days like we have today. We're sitting in a shaded area, but you'd be soaked because not only spray from waterfalls, but the weather changes in an instant. Durable gear is the important part. The waterproof gear. Don't cheap out on a jacket. Make sure you have rain pants that you can pull on. Have the good solid hiking boots and maybe set up maybe hiking trainers or lightweight hiking shoes as well. Don't worry about fashion. Any cotton clothing you have, leave it at home. Because it takes so long for cotton to dry and invariably you are going to get wet.
How did you deal with the day length, with the sunlight hours? I mean, in the summer I know there's very long days, in the winter there's very short days. How was it for you when you were there?
With the summer trip was the most challenging part because it never really got dark. The sun would just dip below the horizon and then come back up. It was a vacation. So we did go out late a few nights where we got in at about 3 o'clock in the morning. But the challenge we had is we were booked on a package tour, a self-drive tour, where the tour company booked locations for us around the island. And they were in guest houses or hotels that work on the traditional, you check in at dinner time, you check out at breakfast time. So those days we're getting in at 3 o'clock in the morning. And then getting up at 7 to leave. Essentially, you've heard the term burning the candle at both ends. Well, we were lighting it in the middle as well. The next day on, we were just dragging. So it was sort of a very busy day, and then we'd have a slower day when we'd get in a little earlier. As far as the September visit, the sun was rising at 8 o'clock in the morning and setting at 6:30 at night, which again, all day long though, the sun never really came too far above the horizon, so the light was beautiful when we had the light.
What was the sunlight in terms of photography? Because you would never get like a blue hour. Sunrise is ongoing.
Well, that's true. You don't get the blue hour, but you get sunset that lasts hours on end. Shooting a sunset, I have a couple of different waterfall shots that I shot at. Essentially, it was almost midnight, and the sun is still in the sky, and it's just amazing. If I were making any recommendation, I would say just be prepared to, in the summertime, your best shooting opportunity is going to be from 11 o'clock at night till 6 o'clock in the morning. But yeah, that was great, which made, during the day, you could do the touristy things, go visit the museums or the churches or what have you, have decent light and still be able to enjoy your other time out shooting the landscape.
How about sunlight hours in September when sun comes up at a more traditional time, goes down at a more traditional time? Do you get sort of an equivalent blue hour that you are used to here?
Well, for our trip, I'm going to say I think so, because I planned this trip around the Northern Lights, middle September to into October. We were there for 2 weeks. And truth be told, we were there for 2 weeks and not once did we see the Northern Lights. We were there at during the wettest September ever for Iceland. The rain was horrendous. That gets back into waterproof gear. But as far as those days that we did have some decent light, it was good. It allowed you to sleep in a little bit longer, and you could go out in the morning and get the light. The other thing, like I said, is the sun doesn't rise very high above the horizon, so it's all long shadows. There's no harsh light in September.
Of all the waterfalls that you shot there, and you shot quite a few, do you have any particular favorites?
Yeah, actually, I have a few. There's one that Brewerfoss. It's this beautiful blue iridescent. The water is it's just amazing. It's not an overly large waterfall by any stretch of the imagination, but it's just the color is absolutely amazing. And in the case when we went, it was one of those locations that you actually had to search out to get there. You parked on a farm road, if you will, and then climbed over a fence and walked through this field. In our case, it was a muddy field for about a kilometer or so to actually find the waterfall. Since then, they've built a parking lot that's a little farther away, but it's easier to access. In the West Fjords, there's a massive waterfall called Dynjandi. It's overwhelming how large it is, and you can walk right up to the edge of the waterfall. Actually, my wife got a really nice shot of me from down below, and I look like a little red speck beside the waterfall.